Israel's secret service, the Mossad, is regarded as one of the most resourceful and ruthless intelligence agencies in the world. But are Israel's top spies on the same page as the country's politicians when it comes to an assessment of the threat posed by Iran? The question was first prompted by my guest today, Meir Dagan, director of the Mossad until a year and a half ago. Just months after retiring, he said an Israeli strike on Iran's nuclear facilities would be stupid. Why did he go so public so quickly? And is there a dangerous gulf between Israel's political leadership and security chiefs? Meir Dagan, welcome to Hard Talk.
Thank you very much for receiving me here.
Well, it's a pleasure. Let's go back a year and start there. You were talking about the idea, seeming growing popularity, of the idea that Israel could launch a military strike against Iran's nuclear facilities 1 year ago, and you said that would be a stupid idea. Have you changed your mind since then?
First of all, I never used the word stupid.
Well, it was widely reported. I've been back and looked at all of the press cuttings. The Hebrew press, the word stupid was used.
I'm not responsible for it. I think it would be, look, the main purpose for, I believe, the international community is prevent of Iran of reaching to a nuclear capability. That's a vital interest of everyone, including Israel, because we were threatened directly by the Iranian. I believe we are the only country in the world that is really threatened by another state, that we don't have even a common border. They want to see us disappearing from this earth.
So if you believe in the threat, why would you use either the word stupid or a word like stupid? Definitely a negative word that you used when you were talking about the idea of an immediate Israeli strike.
I don't think it's going to serve the Israeli goals and the Israeli purposes.
Why?
Because of a few reasons. First of all, you are not able to stop the project by an attack, a military strike. You are able to delay a project. Second, you are going to create a situation that will rally the Iranian public behind the leadership, even though today they are in a very serious internal economical crisis and even a political crisis internally inside Iran. Third, it's going to provide them with a justification for going directly to a nuclear military project. Till now, at least, for the public, they were presenting that they are doing it for peace purposes.
Sure, but what do you believe? I mean, goodness knows, until very recently, you had access to all of the intelligence that Israel could muster. Do you believe that a decision, a strategic decision, to cross the threshold into weaponization has been taken in Tehran?
First of all, I really don't know. I'm assuming that the main purpose, and if we are regarding to the way how they're approaching the nuclear issue, I have no doubt in my mind that they are intending, in the end of the road, to acquire a nuclear military capability. But if they took already such a decision, I really don't know.
You don't know. All right, well look, Ehud Barak, Israel's defense minister, and a man you worked closely with for years, he says that even if you don't know the strategic intent, what you do know inside the intelligence community is that more and more of Iran's nuclear facilities are being put underground, deep underground, in Fordow and other places where they are very difficult to hit. He says that soon Iran will enter this quote-unquote zone of immunity. And that, for him, is the main reason why there has to be discussion of a very imminent military strike.
First of all, what are the criteria that the defense minister is deciding that they are entering in a period of era where nobody will be able to deal with the project?
Well, he's operating on intelligence, presumably, or isn't he?
I believe that some of the facts on the ground are not really backing the presentation of the defense minister.
Really?
Some of them are very deeply covered, but some of them are not covered.
But you're suggesting that Barak, and maybe you would include Netanyahu as well, are in some ways being misleading about what the intelligence is telling them.
I don't think that they are misleading, because let's say Britain is an example. You have excellent intelligence services. You usually will never be building your intelligence picture based on an assumption that here or there a politician is presenting. Usually you are going to make your own assessment and analyze your own situation. Then I don't think that those remarks here and there are really reflecting and encouraging the point of view of different governments.
Well, this is what Barak said after your high-profile intervention last year. He said, whoever keeps saying later, later, in terms of reaching a decision on a military intervention, whoever keeps saying later may find it's too late. And that is an enormous pressure, isn't it?
There is a point in his saying. I cannot rule out that everything that he is saying is not exactly. But I think that this is not the right approach how to stop the nuclear project. If the main goal is to stop the project, I believe you will have to adopt a different policy how to deal with it. And I believe that you always have to have a military option. But such a military option should not be waived as the first priority. You can organize a great deal of pressure on the Iranian regime by threatening the regime, by imposing serious sanction, by preventing of proliferation into Iran, by creating a situation where you are encouraging the opposition internally, and by presenting the costs that the Iranian regime might pay if they are going to go further into this project.
And when you say costs, do you include the targeted killing of Iranian nuclear scientists, for example?
I'm not aiming to this as the cost. Cost, I'm referring to what prices a state is going to pay as a result of isolation, as a result of economical pressure, as a result of unable to solve some of their basic problem because they are still very much dependent on their connection to other countries.
Sure. Well, all right, then let's stick with that for a moment. Then we might come back to targeted killing. But if we stick with the sorts of formulas you've just outlined.
Let me put it one. I have to be clear on one point. I have no intention of dealing with gossip. I have no intention of dealing with rumors.
No, well, I'm not going to deal in gossip either. I'm going to deal in facts. But let's not prejudge that conversation. Let's leave it for a moment. Let's just stick for 1 second more with your formula for putting as much pressure as possible on Iran. What we see right now is a discussion about the next stage of sanctions. You've made a very public call in the last few days for what you call the most robust ever economic sanctions imposed on a nation. And you've talked about complete cut of banking ties with Iran. You've talked about complete embargo on shipping to Iran. And you say that all of these measures will put meaningful new pressure on Tehran. I suggest to you that everything we hear from Tehran makes us believe that would just dig in their defiance.
It's one thing, the rhetoric that the regime in Iran is presenting. From the other end, it's completely a different story when that regime have to face daily problems internally in Iran. This regime is very keen to the public opinion inside Iran. And if those pressures are going to continue, no doubt that the backing that the regime is receiving from the public will lose ground. And if they're going to lose ground, I believe it's a vital element in the policy to be supported by the majority of the Iranian.
But leave aside what might happen inside Iran. I'm very aware, as you sit here, that you were the boss of Israel's secret service. You were not a diplomat. I mean, what makes you think for a moment that you could get the sort of maximum super sanctions you're talking about through the UN Security Council? Because the Russians and the Chinese have given no indication whatsoever they're prepared to go down the route that you want them to go down.
I have a different point of view. I think that even though the Iranians and received some level of a different approach by the Russian and by the Chinese, eventually, when there was a decision about the sanction, even China and Russia voted for it. Then eventually they were aligning themselves with the international community. I think that even China and Russia understand the threat that might come from Iran. Even though I'm agreeing that they are leading a confronting policy, at least the rhetoric is confronting against the United States and the West. Mm. But from the other hand, they are very practical. They know exactly what's going on in Iran, and I believe that in many ways they're adapting the point of view of the international community.
And when it comes to furthering this process, would you say that Israel and your successor in the intelligence services and the security and political leadership as a whole are happy to be guided by American strategy and policy on Iran? Is that a comfortable relationship at the moment in your view?
I think that Israel always kept to what I call an independent policy on issues that are important to our security. But to have a close relationship and a close ties with the United States and having a deep cooperation with the United States, it's a vital element in our security. And I think I'm very happy to see the United States participating in those efforts and trying to fence the Iranian from reaching a nuclear capability.
But put it this way, if Israel were ever to countenance a unilateral strike without American support, do you believe that would be a fundamental mistake?
I think it would be causing a very serious problem in the relationship in Israel and the United States. And I would advise, if I can advise, I'm no longer in the government, it's not my role, that in many aspects, if we can coordinate with the international community, especially with the United States, it's a vital element in our relationship.
All right. That's dealt with some of the diplomatic context. Let's return to something I suggested earlier, which is that there has been a policy of targeted assassination of a number, we believe at least 5 or 6, Iranian nuclear scientists in the last few years. Now, the Iranians, as a fact, have pointed the finger at the Mossad and Israel as prime responsible agent for these killings, at a time when you were still in charge of the Mossad.
Believe me, unfortunately, if they were carrying an event in the Falkland Islands, probably they are going to blame the Mossad. I believe that in many events we have no responsibility and we are not connected. And I believe that the Iranians are suffering from a great deal of internal problems, and they always have a tendency to blame the Israeli, and let's not forget, in many cases they blame even you, the Brits.
So that's an absolute outright denial, but you wouldn't deny, would you, that Israel, and the Mossad in particular, have over decades embraced the idea that targeted killings are justified in Israel's national interest? That's beyond doubt, isn't it?
I never said it, and I have no intention of dealing with anything that is related to the Mossad, and those periods, those issues, are not an issue for discussion from my point of view.
Is that because there is very much a sort of credo in Israel which says when you have run the Mossad, one of the most important security jobs in Israel, you have to be, not just when you're in the job, but after the job, extraordinarily careful about what you say and what you reveal about methods and operations?
Look, I was heading the Mossad for more than 8 years. I have the greatest appreciation to the people who are serving the Mossad. From my point of view, they are doing a unique service to my country. And I have no intention of doing anything that might endanger their activities. Then you're not going to drag
no.
me.
No, I understand that. I just wonder whether you were hurt on a personal level then by, you know, the very pointed criticism that was directed at you after you made this very high-profile intervention on Iran policy last year, because there were, and again, quoting from Haaretz and other Hebrew newspapers, there were Israeli officials saying to journalists in Israel that you, and one quote was, you were sabotaging Israel's democratic institutions by, so soon after doing the job, then talking publicly about Iran policy as a retired Mossad chief.
Maybe I'm mistaken, but I believe in democracy, the heart and soul of democracy, is a public debate. I never discuss operational aspect of it. I was always discussing the issue, what would be wise from the point of view of policies of Israel. And I don't see that, even though I'm a private citizen, that I would be not allowed to present my point of view when every politician, every newspaper in Israel, and everyone in Israel is able to present it. And I think that I care for my country as those people who are criticizing my activity. And even though I finished my period in the Mossad, I still care about my country and my people.
Well, in that context then, let's just quickly look at a few other challenges Israel faces on the diplomatic front in your own region. Let's talk briefly about Syria. In the last few weeks and days, the language from the Syrian government has become much more direct and condemnatory when it comes to Assad. There's been talk of Assad pursuing a genocidal policy, the implication clearly being that, as far as Israel's concerned, it is now clear Assad has to go. Do you think that is altogether wise for Israel?
I believe there are two aspects to it. The first one is the moral aspect. Look, I'm living not far from the Syrian border. And I think that I am, as a Jew, and somebody that his parents survived the Holocaust, can sit quietly when somebody is using the might and the force of a country to execute its own citizens. It's something against my morality, and I believe that anyone who is able to raise his voice against this must do it. That's on the moral point of view, especially the state of Israel.
I understand that point, but then let's move to the Realpolitik, and let's move to the point that some Israelis are worried if you end up with a Sunni victory against the Assad regime, the Ba'athi Alawite regime in Damascus, you could end up with Sunni militants, including some influenced by al-Qaeda, on Israel's doorstep.
I'm not sharing this point of view. I think that in this case, the Iranians are going to lose a stronghold in the Middle East. They're going to lose a very focal point in their influence in the Middle East. I think that the need of the Syrian regime to support Hezbollah is a necessity, and if the regime of Assad is going to fall, I believe that even though I cannot rule out that an Islamic party will take over Syria, I think at the same time we are going to see a much more influential role of pragmatic Arabic states that in a way will moderate some of those activities inside Syria. From the other hand, it will...
You mean the Saudis and the Gulf states?
Yes.
You see them in the ascendancy as a result of what is happening?
Yes.
Well, I just wonder if that applies to your view of Egypt then. You're still obviously very close to the security establishment in Israel. How worried are Israeli leaders and security chiefs right now about the potential for instability in Israel, in Egypt rather, but particularly in the Sinai, in the vast area that borders Israel?
I think this is quite a concern for Israel, because most of the smuggling to the Hamas, unfortunately, is coming to the Sinai. And because of the internal problems today in Egypt, the ability of the Egyptian to prevent penetration of arms and terrorists into coming to Gaza is very limited today, and I believe there's a cause for at least concern in Israel.
Given the turmoil we see in Egypt continuing right now, can you imagine the Egypt-Israel peace unraveling?
First of all, even though I'm coming from a long line of prophets, and we invented prophecy and we wrote some books about it, I'm not a prophet. We have a president, his name is Peres, a very unique personality.
We know him on this program.
Yes. He told me once, if you make any prediction for the future, do it for 50 years. For two reasons. One, nobody's going to remember what after 50 years what you said. And second, if somebody will remember, you're not going to be around for 50 years. I think that, but to be serious on the Egyptian side, I think that the situation in Egypt is a great concern for Israel. I don't think there is an immediate threat to the peace agreement between Israel and Egypt. I think that even, let's say theoretically, that the Muslim Brotherhood will win, even though it might cause a very serious impact and backlash into the region, but in the short terms, I think the Muslim Brotherhood are going to be very much occupied with all their own internal problems.
Pragmatic.
Yes.
Before we end, I want to ask you one last thing, which brings you directly back home to Israel. You have voiced support for the fundamental Land for Peace deal. You've suggested Israel should be serious about pursuing dialogue over the Saudi peace plan, which would involve basically a return to the 67 lines with some adjustments on either side. But you clearly see that as the route to peace. That is not a route, frankly, that the current government is following. How worried are you about the, how can one put it, the limbo that the Israel-Palestinian peace mechanism has fallen into?
I know that many people from many sides are usually, when you ask the Palestinians who is to blame that we were not successful in the dialogue, they will say the Israelis. If you ask the Israelis will say the Palestinians.
Yeah, but I'm asking you to tell me what you really think.
Yes, I think that eventually, in some point in time, it's a necessity for the two communities to reach an agreement. Unfortunately...
And that will be land for peace. It will be based upon the 67 line.
I believe that it was presented even by Prime Minister Netanyahu. I never said the 67 borders. I said that it would be land for peace.
Your vision of the future includes an Israeli government that is prepared to move against thousands, tens of thousands of Jewish settlers on occupied land and tell them that their settlements must be closed down, that they must move back into Israel. They have no future on occupied territory. Do you believe that you see a willingness amongst any of the Israeli political leaders right now to take that difficult decision?
I'm not the Israeli government. I have no ability
of taking...
No,
I'm asking you,
yeah.
I'm asking you for your assessment of whether there's that ability, that willingness.
Personally, I'm even against moving some of the settlers. I think we can arrange a swap of lands between us and the Palestinians.
But with respect, whatever the land swap, it's not going to save the homes of tens of thousands of Jewish settlers. You know it, everybody knows it, if there is to be a meaningful peace.
I agree that it will need for hard decision by the State of Israel. And I believe that any government that is going to sit down seriously on the issue will have to take hard decision that will be very painful for the country. It's not easy to move settlers. Personally, I don't think that you have to move all of them. You can arrange some solution that could be providing a solution for the two sides. But no doubt, any solution is going to be a painful solution.
With that thought, Meir Dagan, we have to thank you for being on Hard Talk. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.